Greetings. I am Orin Adcox, and I'm a game artist and an animator. I came up through Mason here in both of those fields, so I double majored. And I'll talk about sort of what my skill and what my experience is here. And I'd be lying if I said it wasn't a lot of fortune. I basically followed the line from one thing to another and kind of worked my network of contacts as I was coming up. You know, I'll talk about the history right here, actually. I started actually at a community college because I'm kind of cheap and I wanted to save some money, but I wasn't sure what I was going to do. I wanted to do illustration, and I eventually wanted to do concept art. I knew that since I was maybe 10 or so. But I didn't know where I wanted to go, and it was only through the luck of talking to some friends and figuring out, oh, hey, Mason has a game program, that I decided to pursue art. So I didn't actually go into game immediately. I went here with the intention of doing art and then picking up game design as a minor. I liked it enough and wanted to learn more that I picked up as a double major, and stuck in school maybe a little longer than I intended to. I lucked out a little bit in some regards where I had made contacts and talked to people before, and through almost some dumb luck, I was able to have somebody that I had met years ago contact me kind of out of the blue because of a reference from a friend. And I got an internship over at the Virginia Serious Game Institute. Now, from there, I did quality work. And that actually goes back to what this original part in the slide is, where it's serendipity and timing. You don't just luck into a situation. It's not just pure fortune. You do have to build up your portfolio constantly. You know, you always have to be prepared for whatever situation it is, because your network of people that you are talking to is just all of your relationships that you run into. If you don't cultivate those relationships, if you don't treat everybody as an individual, not just a means to that end, and work on those things, then you won't necessarily get the jobs that you want. And it can come from anywhere. I first got a referral for a portfolio from somebody I worked with when I was working at Target doing my undergrad. And then that person later on went to work at Naughty Dog. So just the people you talk to can branch off into every different things. And with everybody in the game major, you guys are going to go in all these different directions. So building communities and talking with each other is actually very important to building up each other's skills. Something that happens in the art department all the time too, with critiques and portfolio reviews and things. So at my internship, that company stuck around for a little while, but it didn't necessarily build off into a whole bunch of different games. It was actually founded by one of the people that went through this graduate program in game design first. But there I did a few different assets. We were mostly working on a fishing sort of tower fall game, if you're familiar with those. And then I fell into a few other things. So I continued with my degree. I did a little bit more internship and independent study out there at the VSGI. So I became familiar with everybody there, and they got to see the quality of my work, which admittedly I guess was pretty all right, because they decided not to kick me out. So then as soon as I graduated, I had talked to that graduate student who was actually on his way out. And he was the one that was sending out the emails to everybody. And he was sending out an email for these mobile game competition winners. It was in, I believe, 2017. And I jumped on that as soon as I could, asked, hey, what are the portfolio requirements for this? And sent off my portfolio as soon as I could. From there, I got hired to both of these. So there was a major winner, and then there was a runner-up. And the major winner was doing a pixel art escape room game, and then the runner-up was doing a sort of kids dress-up game. You'll see the pictures of both of those later on. but I worked both of those over the summer, and then I actually fell into teaching for Mason Game and Technology Academy too, which is teaching kids game design if you haven't done that. And so I had a lot of opportunities, a lot more networks and contacts. So I was doing outreach events for it as well as teaching for MGTA, and that'll lead into another conversation in a moment. But from there, we kept working with that pixel art escape room game, even past sort of where we started to run out of funding. But we were asked, so, hey, what's your plan to do? You know, we had mentorships at the VSGI, and they're asking, okay, so you've gone this far. You have basically your vertical slice of a game. Are you going to take this any further, or what are you guys planning to do? So we decided, yeah, why not? Let's found a company. It wasn't my intent, you know, when I went from community college to found a game company and run a lot of those day-to-day operations, but I sort of ended up there. And from there, I've been able to have lots more experiences. I'm going to talk about the brief experiences I have here at Mason. And to anybody that's taken Grimsby's digital painting class, the skull will look familiar. Because that all the skills I built up under that undergrad factored into my opportunities that I had later on. So, and I want to try to talk about the overview of that. Like, what are the skills that I personally developed, and what helped me succeed? So I'm primarily an artist and animator, but I try to make sure I honed all the other skills, right? Like, I do a lot of 2D and a lot of 3D, but I want to make sure I can talk to my programmer, I can talk to my sound designer. And that is one of the biggest takeaways that I have from the game design program, is that it is holistic. Everybody that comes out of here and people that I hire at the VSGI, like, I expect them to know a little bit of programming, a little bit of sound design. I expect them to be able to work in a team and talk to each other. And that's not necessarily something you get at a whole bunch of other colleges around. And I've worked at outreach events all over the country at this point. So I've talked to a lot of different places that have, you know, shown them that. And they're like, oh, that's a very different take on this. Obviously, coming from 3D and animation, taking all of Grimsby's like 3D classes and Pachoni's as well, were invaluable to me. I would suggest if you have a specific thing you want to hone in on, take as many classes as you can in that, while still, you know, continuing to build up the other processes. You have one or two things that are like your main point, but you know, I've hired people before that are 3D animators and they know a little bit of programming, or 3D animators and they know how to render really well. Just very specific skills that are slightly off of what your main competing hires might be. So let's see. Oh, don't be just an idea guy. I'm sure plenty of us have run into this, especially in like the undergrad, where, especially in like your first year, where somebody comes up in your team, they're really excited about the project, and they're the idea guy. Doesn't mean they know how to 3D model, doesn't mean they know how to program, doesn't mean they know anything about sound. Doesn't even mean they want to design, they're the idea guy. Don't be the idea guy. You always have to have another skill to build onto your team. Like, it doesn't matter in any way you can help. Like, you have to not only be able to come up with a base concept, but deliver on it in some way. And that could be design. That could be paper prototyping. But so long as you don't just come up with, yeah, here's the idea. All right, you guys execute. You know, Kojima isn't running around doing that. Or he's doing that now, but it's not like he started out that way. So let's see. Oh, and what I wish I did. I wish I went to more conventions, actually. I didn't go to any conventions like East Coast Game Conference or GDC when I was an undergrad. So being able to network in those contacts and actually going out and seeing more industry professionals when I was an undergrad would have been more valuable. So I wish I did that more. I've gotten to do that a little bit since now. But okay, so I'm also like a VSGI researcher. So I'm over at VSGI pretty much all the time, like at least 6 or 7 days a week, I think, at this point. So I've gotten to participate in lots of cool things besides just going to different game conferences. I actually got to go to China back in 2018, part of Tencent's functional game. It's basically what they call serious games. And for those of you that haven't worked in serious games, it's games for a purpose outside of just entertainment value. So you have the educational or the training component of it. And it was interesting. So it was obviously very bilingual presentation. So if you've never given one of those, it's very interesting to have to jump between languages for like every sentence that you're doing. And then you get the feedback. And if you don't know Mandarin, sometimes it can be tricky. So it's me on stage explaining kind of how our game went over the few days that we did like a game jam. And I don't know if it hit right. So we'll see. But it was very interesting. It was a good experience to travel and to communicate with peers outside of not only the native country, but very different cultures and things like that. I've also been able to co-write some papers with Stephanie Kane specifically of the VSGI, another graduate student. And that was about another functional like framework, and that kind of detailed some best practices when you're doing functional / serious game design. Currently, I'm working a lot with a historical movement archive, which is like digitizing motion capture and traditional like historical movement and combat, stage combat and dance as well, just because you can't get all the context from a video or a treatise. So I feel like I should show you some various work over my course of the VSGI, and that's everything from projects that lasted, you know, a few weeks, because it was, we need that prototype now, we got to deliver it to, say, Fairfax County Public Schools, and they want to see this implemented in classes immediately. And in this case, I animated both the little kobold at the bottom and the little orc in the course of a few weeks. The historical movement archive stuff, you can see there's 3D animation. And I did some adjustments in the skinning and the modeling, but a lot of that is dealing with motion capture data. So. And you can see the little fish from the fish game. You can see the background I did originally. And there's the kids dress-up game, and there's the pixel art escape room game. I show this primarily to explain that even if you're going in with a very particular style of art, and I'm coming from an art background, same thing with programmers, if you're coming with a very specific skill set, you might have to branch out. You might learn a couple different things in that space. But it's always great to pick up the lessons that you have from all those people as you go through. So. And all those different experiences, even if it doesn't seem like it's a perfect fit immediately. So let me talk a little bit about the business. like I said, I was very fortunate in the way I fell into some of this. And when I was doing MGTA outreach, I was actually doing it off the wall here. And I came into talking to somebody that was looking to basically not only build her like dissertation on how to keep a trail clean and how you can affect environments, but she also runs a business that basically is an in-between between different businesses. She did a lot of work with USAID. So our first contract was actually as a sub of a sub of a sub for USAID. And that was particularly just talking about how to deliver aid to different countries and to make sure it was implemented well in there and all the different nuances of it that the designer might not think of. I also have recently done a group with or some collaboration with communities and schools, which I think some of you might be familiar. And with that group, it's basically a social-emotional evaluation tool in the back end of a game for kids, roughly third grade or so, because they can't fill out a questionnaire saying, hey, what's self-efficacy or how do I feel about this particular environment? It kind of evaluates that in the back end. So in the trail game, I mentioned briefly, it's about an ecology kind of preservation and making sure that you don't affect the environment. And then we've actually ended up doing some consulting because, again, a contact. I was asked to go talk down to ECGC, East Coast Game Conference, and I gave a talk there. And from that, we got a client that was that wanted us to take a look at the game and see how we'd optimize it. So really, you get unexpected work in unexpected places. So, and it's always good to kind of keep that in mind as you go to different places. In entertainment games, we're currently working on a rhythm fighting game, and you've seen the Pixel Art Escape Room game. So that's just a little bit of that. But I do have specific advice for you guys, right? Research the developers that you like the most, the people that have the portfolios that you're like, I want that job specifically. The things that really wow you, the things that are really the jobs that you want in the places that you want, and see how they got there specifically. If they have, you know, if they're opening up on Twitter and they're like, hey, we'll do portfolio review, then take that opportunity. Don't just, you know, cold call somebody, although I've seen people do that and sometimes it works. I'm not telling you to do that, but anyways, you also need to network as much as you can. We've covered it probably a little bit in some classes before, but just talking to people, building communities, Discords, just class critique, even just meeting outside of school, having like sketch jams or like a programming session or game jams really helps build a community of peers that can talk to each other and you have a shared passion. And then like again, research portfolios and make sure you kind of know what you're looking for. So some concluding thoughts, and these are probably relevant in all of your life, not just in your game design life, is unexpected opportunities arise from unexpected places, right? So you always have to keep something in mind when you're going to different places. If you can not use that person as a means to an end, but as an actual person and see kind of what they know. What are they doing right now? What are they working on? Who do they know? And just getting to know people and having contacts like that, you can basically build just sort of lexicon of knowledge in a bigger community. Always improve and learn from those around you. It's great to learn from your mistakes. It's better to learn from somebody else's mistakes. And I always try to do that in everything I do. Through being in a business incubator, I've seen a lot of companies fail, and I've been able to grow from that and try to, you know, basically make sure I don't fall into those same pitfalls. I fell into different pitfalls, and I have to adjust and, you know, work from that. And then while you're mastering a few skills, improve all of them. Like I talked about this earlier, but if you're a programmer, be really good at what you do, but also know how to implement the art. Also know how the sound design gets implemented. Maybe you get hired on for a rhythm game. Maybe you get hired on for a game and they need somebody to implement this thing. The skill sets I've seen for people to get hired really depends on what they're looking at the very specific time point. And you don't know what that person hiring is looking for other than, I need a Unity programmer. They might not know the specifics of what they need, but they know the project overview. And then you get an interview and you talk with them and you're like, oh, I can do this and this and this. Otherwise, we'll open it to questions now. And that concludes my presentation. So.
Thank you very much, Orin, for that amazing presentation. Very insightful. So I have a few questions I'd like to pose, and then I'd like to open it up to the audience to see if they have any as well from your presentation. The first one, could you characterize a positive, successful interview of an intern or a part-time or full-time person that applied for a position at Fly Guy, and maybe, you know, a bad one, and tell the audience the differences?
Well, I've looked at it. I haven't had too many bad ones, at least personally at my company, although there's some at the VSU that probably weren't great. I would say, first I utilize a network of contacts, and a lot of times if I can get a good reference for some people, that definitely helps. It puts people a leg
now,
up.
Do you check references prior to interviewing them, or after or?
Oh, definitely prior. If I need somebody for a particular task, I'm curious. I look around for people that I do trust the recommendations of first, and then kind of see what their field of, what people do they know in their network that would work really well for this thing. What do they specialize in? And you know, what's the general availability? So somebody might be great, but if they don't fit the slot I need for the job, or they can't make the time requirements, then I'm not going to use them. Or if they don't come back with me quick enough when I send a message out.
Are specific skills, personality traits, because culture is obviously important. A Fly Guy has their own culture.
Right.
So could you let us know, tell us a little bit about, deal breakers.
Yeah,
if
so.
Somebody was applying. For
not being available enough is definitely probably the biggest one, just because the nature of game dev is that we aren't always meeting in person, and some of these, I need you to be able to respond like within a reasonable amount of time. I'm not saying immediately, but... if I send out a Discord message in our chat and I'm like, hey, I need you to go ahead and do this bug fix real quick. The client's really, not irritated, but really interested in getting this out tomorrow. We had one, or if we have a particular project that has a deadline. Like, I try to avoid crunch. I think crunch is a failure of management, but it happens sometimes. And I need to make sure my team is understandable of that and is flexible enough that if I say, hey, we have a project that has to go to Ghana tomorrow, we all three need to stay up all night and work on this thing, and that's a real experience, then I can count on my team for that. They're not going to just drop off and be like, all right, good luck. So
what types of, let's say, for instance, you throw out a job announcement, and you don't have that person's not in your network.
Right.
But you like their skill sets.
Right.
Right? And so they come for an interview. What type of questions would you pose to them? What are you looking for?
Well, it depends on what their skill set is,
okay.
Right? If I looked at the portfolio...
Well, non-technical, I guess.
Right. I guess, because I still want to know what they took away from the thing. So if I see that a programmer made something in a level, I want to know specifically what their mindset was when they made this. How do they implement things, and what learning experience do they have from that? Because that'll inform me more about how they handle new tasks. How quick do they learn? How amiable are they? Do they communicate well? Like, those are things I always look for when we're interviewing people.
So. That's fantastic. So tell us, let's say you hired someone and you thought they were fantastic, but they weren't, right? So what do you do?
Do you
fire them on the spot?
No.
don't come back? I mean, what do you?
Well, I mean,
how do you manage?
I'm a co-owner of a company. I'm not my own island, so I definitely have to talk with other co-founders.
That's critically important.
Yeah, I have to talk with other co-founders and see kind of what they feel about the particular needs of that project. A, can we fill that position quickly? Because that's great. They're not working out. Well, we can't necessarily get rid of them then. One of the things we have to do is make sure that there's a clear line of performance evaluations and it is an established thing. You don't want to just fire somebody on the spot most of the time, and a lot of times you can work with people to improve. I'm not going to necessarily throw somebody out if I think there is room for improvement. But if I can, if there's no hope, if they're consistently upset, have messed up, then I'm going to have a chat. So,
interesting. One more question for me, and I'll open it up. Can you tell us what was it like, the biggest challenge in forming your own game studio?
Honestly, all the logistics. Somebody without a business background falling into that and trying to learn. We developed a business plan through mentorship in the course of maybe a few months over summer, and we had a crash course in that. I didn't know what really. What a K-1 partnership form was, what your EBITDA was, what your, just handling all of those logistics were kind of the most interesting thing. That and being able to do good client relationships, I would say. I think I only now am able to craft a nicely worded email that works well and is professional to the degree that needs to be with a client. So,
very good. Very insightful. Okay, anyone have any questions?
How valuable are skills outside of directly game design? What if you had a background psychology or economics?
Well, interestingly enough, we actually had a professor here that had a background in psychology. I think he was working at Maxis before this. So, and game design, psychology is actually a great example, because game design and psychology actually meld pretty well, because you're, especially as a designer, because you're trying to figure out exactly what appeals to people, what's rewarding. I think as long as you lean into sort of what your experiences are and you make them part that builds to the greater whole, then I think you can own almost anything.
Okay. All right, so a lot of professors will often talk about working outside of class to make sure that you have stuff that you can put on your portfolio. What kinds of work were you doing outside of class to kind of at your portfolio to build up work before going into your first real job?
Right. So building your portfolio is never an ending task. Like, you're always replacing things, and you want to just have maybe half a dozen like really good pieces, at least as an artist. And I was always trying to do personal projects in the very limited amount of free time I had. After I graduated, I think I had like four jobs at the same time at one point. But before that, I was working working part-time through all of my undergrad. So finding the spare time to do little projects when I could. And a lot of times, if I'm doing 3D modeling, I might do like pixel art on the side to kind of, you know, get a palate cleanser, just because I'm doing a lot of different stuff. But I'd also look at tutorials online all the time. I think I have like 700 unwatched videos on my watch later list on YouTube, and I'm like, that's a great tutorial. I want to watch that later when I have time. Because there's always something I can glean, and I'm always trying to learn, and you never stop. So I would say constantly improve your portfolio, always try to find what even little spare time you can do to projects that are within your scope. So, you know, maybe you want to do this fantastic landscape painting, but you don't really have time to do, like, essentially like a rough, you know, version of that. Maybe that's what you do. As long as it looks good, so long as it looks established and it's kind of that intent, so.
That's great.
Thank you.
Hi. What is your most important professional and personal trait?
Oh, God. I assume good things, right?
Yeah.
Not necessarily. Okay.
He remembers this exercise.
Yeah, whether or not I remember my answers then is a whole other topic. Professional trait, one of the good ones. I would say that I'm fairly organized in the things I do. Like, sometimes it can get frantic running a small company because it's like, oh, right now I need to get taxes settled up. I need to collect all of my 1099s, and I need to make sure that all the projects are running properly. I need to make sure that we have money coming in, and then all of the other like research stuff I do. So just being able to compartmentalize my time so I understand this half my day is for this, this half my day is for that, has become a skill that's become invaluable. And then personally, I think, My ability to adapt is one of the personal things that I take the most, because that's not just adapting in a workspace, right? That is emotional adapting to like whatever life situation you have. You know, maybe you have to go deal with getting your car taken care of, while then you have to run into work and you have to be flexible like emotionally as well, right? So especially in like any personal relationship you have, you know, if you go home to a girlfriend and you have to make sure that like you listen to her and you talk to her, that's just as important as organizing your time at work. So they kind of play off each other, but they're both.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I would concur. I think you're also time management. You're very good at time management, and you have to be in all the roles that he has. Other questions? Yeah.
Hi. So I was wondering, from your personal experience, what is the best way to present yourself to future employers with the best works that you have shown possible without also coming off as like arrogant, as if you kind of like know everything already in the industry?
Yeah, well, being humble gets you a long way. Like, you want to be confident in your work, but you don't want to come off as a braggart. And it also depends on the work culture you're looking at. Research, do a lot of research about the companies you're applying, because your application to each of those companies is going to be different. It really depends on kind of what they're looking for, but being amiable for one, being able to like laugh at jokes and like be like, you know, comfortable in that space, be it over a phone interview or in person, and those are two very different things, and some people interview for one better than the other. Just make sure you always put your best foot forward. I know it's cliche, but put your best foot forward in those regards. So if you're gonna hone into a specific kind of application, make sure that it highlights you well.
One more?
In general, are there any particular skills or programs that would be especially good to know or would really stand out to employers?
It depends on what you're looking for, right? Because I don't know if all of you want to go into entertainment game design, or if you guys want to do 3D modeling, because there's more jobs than just entertainment games, right? And especially in this area, where if you type in Unity developer into like Indeed, you don't get just hits that are, you know, this entertainment studio. It's not just Bethesda up the road. It's government contractors a lot, and sometimes they pay better. It's just trying to figure out kind of what are the jobs in your area and seeing where those niches need to be filled. And some of those might be, maybe you don't just reach out to entertainment people on Twitter that work at like Blizzard. Maybe you reach out to people that work at companies that are like government contractors and things like that. Because, you know, I know people right now that are building, 3D models of like embassies and things for defense purposes and that kind of stuff. So it really just depends. There's lots of different kinds of work that can be done, but you do need to do the research to figure out what skill sets are part of that, what things do you think they're missing, and how do you sell yourself for that.
How about a question from a young lady? It's all been young men, so.
What would you say was the most challenging aspect of creating a portfolio?
Finding the time for one. I mean, I think we could all relate to that as, I'm still not happy with mine. I'm always trying to work on it, and I'm trying to build stuff on the side. It's both the presentation on it, because I don't know like HTML, and I don't really have any web dev experience. But
you've done it.
I've done it a little bit. Yeah. I've delegated it a little bit, and I know how to hire and talk to the right people. I know how it works in large concept, but I don't know how to write HTML code. But being able to put together a portfolio that looks good and that showcases your art well, or your stuff well, art, programming, sound design. You need to make sure, again, it goes into the same thing as, you know, applying for a specific job. Make sure it's tailored for in a way that shows off your strengths the best it is. We'll talk about more portfolio review in classes and things, but really understanding what your strengths are, picking a few good pieces, and organizing them and presenting them well are kind of the key features.
Thank you.
Last one.
What kind of works would you expect to see on a portfolio for someone who's applying for character design?
It really depends on the project I'm looking at, right? If I'm working on pixel art, I'd like to see pixel art in their portfolio. If I'm working on a 2D fighting game, I'd like to see some of that. 3D modeling, same sort of thing. It depends on what my needs are. And you're not always going to know what the employer needs are, but that's where they're coming from as their basis. It's like, what do I need to slot into this thing? So that's why I stress research, because different companies look for different things. Being well-versed in a little bit of all of that, somebody that like started out wanting to do exclusively concept art, understanding human proportions for characters is key. Like, you have to be able to draw people. Like, there's no way you're going to get around that. Even if you want to draw aliens and monsters and everything else. I also look That's to right. see how fast they can do it. Like, if there's a certain level of completion, I don't think it's necessarily a requirement to say how long it took you on all of your art stuff, but to be able to have an idea, and I would ask that in the interview, actually. How long did some of these take? And get a good idea, because that helps me with my pipeline of planning.
Well, thank you very much, Orin.
No problem.
Fantastic. Thank you for visiting us.